So main thing at Sella, we say about the grip. Yep. You can see these two here now. Left hand side, now right hand way underneath there. Your left finger, your sort of fingers on your right hand, really sort of underneath there, sort of folding over the thumb, very much underneath grip position. That's going to cause the club now to come back to the golf ball, aiming over there. So because of this now with the club aiming left, you did a few things at setup. You aimed your feet further right of target, and you try to sort of block the golf club as you came, trying to hold the club face open. And if we watch this one here now as you come through, sort of left arm sort of pulling through, trying to hold the club face. Stiff and tight, and just, as I said, doing everything you possibly can to try and stop it going to the left. Okay. Other thing we said now in terms of the swing, there was your backswing before. Okay, that's where your club goes back furthest. Okay. Now compare that to here. So we said about hinging the wrist. Just push your arms back as you were, and hinge the wrist as the club goes back. There's your backswing there now. So you went back there.
Up over my head.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that's where you go. You see you're hinging the wrist up there now. You're getting a good L shape, and now there. So that's your backswing. So that's why you're getting now your eight iron 120, 130, 140, and your hybrid was 175 plus, because you were just swinging the golf club back further. The golf swing is a circle around your body, and you were going on the circle a little bit shorter. So you were there maybe at sort of 10 o'clock, and now we're getting to almost beyond 12, 12:30, almost towards 1 o'clock. So you're increasing the amount of power you're creating on the way back. And that's where the power comes from. If you swing the golf club to here, okay, you'd get a better contact now because of the strike and the position you're in is better, but the power wouldn't be much. It would go a little bit further because of the better contact you're going to get. If that's going 70 or 80 yards, maybe 100 at best, you get about the same with that, maybe a smidgen more. Now you're swinging the golf club back further, you're just creating more power. So from there now we can just release the body and arms through, nice and relaxed, and we can rotate through, get a full release of the club. See how your right arm now is sort of naturally, get all these circles, is naturally now folding over your left arm. It's a bit blurry. You can see your right hand is just doing this release of the club as you're coming through. It's just letting your arms fold the club over and naturally releasing up to the top of your back, to the top of your finish position. All your weight now is predominantly, I would say, through that left side. The right foot sort of got a little bit out of control just because you're not quite used to making that move yet.
Partly because you've never done that.
You're now moving your body. And what happens? Once your hips do this and your shoulders do that, your right foot's going, I've got to do something. I can't sort of stay on the floor, otherwise I'll damage my knee.
Far under me.
Yeah, it's kind of, you've gone a little bit more over the top and you sort of spun your foot. If you watch when the foot comes through, it just sort of spins around on its toe rather than the knees actually moving this way to target, which we'll sort of show in a second. But it's more of an afterthought move. But it's doing whatever it can to keep up with a better movement of your body. That's all. It's not used to doing that, so therefore in the past you didn't have to worry about it.
Yeah.
Now it's like, well, hang on, I'm moving a bit more now. I've got to start trying to keep up with these bad boys. But yeah, certainly the takeaway now, mate, that for me, very, very good position. The position you're getting that club into there now, I mean, you can sort of image that on anyone, any good golfer, can't you? It's a good position. Again, the longer clubs will go back a smidgen further, just because they're longer.
Yeah.
And we're going to get more and more power as we go back. But getting that move to the top there, lovely strike as we can see. And again, I think you was almost quite pleasantly surprised how far it was actually going. 130 with an 8-iron, and then I say the hybrid there was about 175. And like I say, I would stick to using your irons and your hybrid at the max until you just feel, though, you go on the driving range, you're going, I can hit my driver now, let's take it to the range, to the golf course.
Yeah.
If you can't do on the range 10 or 7 out of 10, it's not going to happen on the exactly. Under pressure on the golf course when it matters and you get one ball, and if you don't get it right as a consequence, there's lost balls, trees, bunkers, whatever it may be, going to work. So yeah, take the driver out with you. If you play with the hybrid off the majority of your tees, again a low tee, not too high a tee if you're off the tee peg, and then off the ground as well, you can play it. Maybe if you start playing hole 10 11 12 13 14, if you get to a hole, I can hit a driver now, give it a go. If it doesn't work, fine, get out of the trees, recover, put it back in the bag until you then play the next time around. Okay, but start introducing it in dribs and drabs based on how the practice is going. If you go to the range and hit 50 driving, they're all rubbish. There's no point having the golf course, exactly. But again, in terms of your practice, go through your back.
Yeah.
Go through your 8-iron, your 9-9, your 6, your hybrid and all the different clubs.
So the way I was hitting like the 8-iron and line-up, I think that's the same for all my irons.
Every iron, we'll go through a different couple of irons now if you want to before we finish off. We go through the whole bag. It's basically what you want to try and do is create one circle around your body with the same different movement, or so the same movement but different club. So your 9-iron, your pitching wedge, your 7-iron, your 8, your 6, 5, whatever, they're all the same. So again, the driver's the same swing. Well, the more loft of a sand iron, your sand iron's basically, you've got your 7-iron loft,
so it's just about that,
your sand iron's got 56 degrees.
Yeah.
And the way to look at it is if you've got a 90 degree sort of angle chart here, roughly speaking, okay, if that's 45 degrees, roughly, anything below 45 degrees, okay, 44 and down with the loft, So you look at your pitching wedge is 46,
okay,
ballpark figure. Your 9's 44, 8 40 and 7 36. Anything below 45 wants to go lower and forward.
Okay.
Anything more than 45 wants to go up the
shorter.
So 45, 50, 56 with your sand iron. Lob wedges are 60, 65. They want to go straight up in the air. So the harder you hit them, the higher they go. Exactly, yeah. Now, what people do struggle with sometimes is how far that ball needs to be hit and how hard an effort you're going to give it, and only goes 40. Exactly. It's just understanding how far. Related again to rugby, a guy kicks a ball like a Gary Owen straight up in the air, he wallops it, he goes 50 feet up in the air and goes 10 yards forward, or he bunts it flatter, it goes further. So it's just understanding trajectory and what each club's going to give you, but that will just come through practicing shots on the driving range. But take your chance that when you go to the range, use all the clubs. So many guys go to range and want to just beat the golf ball as far as they can. It's nice and it's enjoyable whacking the ball 200 yards, but same token on the golf course, you've got to learn how to play these shots around the green. Okay, right, have a couple then with that 7-iron, and then we'll go through some of the rest of the bag.